Gather around the fire, Souls fans. It's time to talk about one of the more innovative and challenging game series to come out in the last decade, Dark Souls. I'm Jeremy Ray, aka Junglist, Australian games writer and huge Dark Souls fan.
And I'm Michael, also known on YouTube for my Dark Souls videos as Vati Vidya. We're gearing up for a third Dark Souls release, and this time, the Lords of Cinder have abandoned their thrones. It's our job to bring them back. And to this end, we've created a video that we hope will help you do this.
We've cut this video up into little sections so you can skip to whatever you want to. Make sure you check the description below. If you're new to Dark Souls, you will want to watch these videos. And veterans will find useful stuff towards the end as well. Should we get started?
Let's do it.
Let's start out with what's on your screen. This right here is your health bar. Healing is limited in Dark Souls 3, so every little bit counts. Whenever you take damage from enemies or obstacles, your health bar depletes. If it reaches zero, you die. Below it is the stamina bar. Doing attacks, blocking, or rolling all take stamina. Stamina regenerates quickly, however, it regenerates slower whenever your shield is raised. You want to practice being aware of both these bars at all times because it affects your playstyle. Low on health? Don't panic, but just back off a little bit and try to find some time to heal. Low on stamina? Lower your shield so you can regenerate, because without it, you won't be able to block and you won't be able to fight. Down in the bottom left, you've got your right hand weapon and left hand weapons. You can have three of each accessible at any one time. Above is your magic spells that you can have with you, and below are your selected items. Lastly, in the bottom right is the amount of souls you have. These are gained by killing enemies and exploring. You can either spend these as currency or use them to become more powerful and level up. We recommend not carrying around too many souls at once because you can lose them all if you die.
Be sure to bring more souls.
The class you start as in Dark Souls is by no means an indication of where you're going to end up. The cleric can easily become the pyromancer, and the thief may put aside his knife to become the knight. Just remember, what a starting class does is give you a certain boost to a certain playstyle. Before we get to stats, we need to discuss where you level up and how you actually do it. After the tutorial area, you reach Firelink Shrine. Within, you'll create your first bonfire using the coiled sword you pulled from Eudex Gundyr. Nearby, you'll find the Firekeeper, who you should have a chat with.
Welcome to the bonfire, Unkindled One.
She offers you the ability to level up your character should you have the souls to do so.
Very well. Then touch the darkness within me.
But which stats should you level up? This part of Dark Souls can be a lot to get your head around, so we're going to go through each stat one by one. Here are all the stats that you can level up. Every time you spend souls to level up a stat, your level increases by one, and the amount of souls you need for the next level increases. On the right are the values that increase as you level up your character, shown in blue. This should give you an idea of what leveling up each stat does. If you need help on this screen, then you can press select for a description, but let's go over the stats now since you're here. Vigor relates to your health. Upgrade that and your health bar will increase. Endurance is the same thing for your stamina bar. And vitality relates to how much equipment you can carry. The less equipment you have on you, the faster you'll move and roll, and the less stamina will be used in combat. Edging towards your maximum weight will make you roll like this. Keeping your equipment load below 70% of your maximum will make sure you're fast and agile.
The attunement stat increases the length of your focus bar and governs how many spells you can bring into battle. Every few points in attunement creates a new slot for more spells. Strength is fairly straightforward. Some weapons will become more powerful the higher your strength stat is, and these weapons can be good at breaking enemy defenses through sheer force. Dexterity is similar. Certain weapons will scale up in the damage they do along with this stat, and they are usually finesse weapons like bows or rapiers.
Down the bottom, intelligence affects the power of your sorceries and fire magic, and similarly, faith affects the power of your miracles, lightning, fire, and dark magic.
New to Dark Souls 3, dexterity now also decreases the time it takes to cast a spell.
Luck is a stat that increases item discovery. This means every time you kill an enemy, there's a higher chance that something valuable will drop. Keep in mind certain items will drop no matter what, like the souls of bosses you beat. There may also be some items that scale with luck.
There's one other value that warrants a bit of attention, and that's poise. Different armors have different poise values, and basically, the higher your poise, the less you'll be staggered or interrupted during an enemy's attack. The heavier your armor, the more poise it will give, but the slower your character will be. And beware, in Dark Souls 3, there are actually some armor sets that have negative poise values.
The weapons, armor, and spells that you find may have stat requirements that must be met before they can be used properly. For example, here we have a Winged Knight Halberd. The Winged Knight Halberd requires 26 strength and 16 dexterity before it can be wielded effectively. In the case of weapons, holding it with two hands effectively halves the strength requirements. On this note, bear in mind that Souls games treat stats more as a means to an end. It's great to have extra health, but it's more important to find a weapon and armor set that you feel comfortable with and build your stats around that. If that hammer scales A with strength, you'll want a lot of strength. Or if you fell in love with the heavy armor, you're gonna have to plan around its weight. How you build and arm your character is important, but not as much as player skill. Dark Souls is about leveling up your avatar, but it's also about leveling up yourself.
As you venture into the land of Lothric, you're going to acquire souls. These can be used to imbue yourself with more power, but also to buy items at the shrine. Should you die, and trust me, you're going to die, you'll leave a green bloodstain at your point of death, in which the souls you had on you are kept. Reach this bloodstain, touch it, and you'll regain your souls. Fail to reach it and die again, and they're lost forever. With this in mind, remember, it's always a good idea to go back to your shrine when you have a lot of souls on you.
What a sick joke. Asking us to seek the Lords of Cinder and return them to their moldering thrones. We're talking true legends, those who would link the fire. We're not fit to lick their boots.
The bonfires that pepper the land are your beacons of hope. The bonfires are linked to each other, allowing you to travel between them at will. But be warned, resting at a bonfire will regenerate both you and the world around you. Your health and potions will be replenished, but all enemies will return as well. In Dark Souls 3, the real checkpoints are the permanent changes you can make to the world before it's time to sit by the fire. After death, you'll be in an unkindled state, which means your maximum health will be reduced, and you'll also be cut off from some multiplayer options. There's two ways we know of to reverse this process. You can either consume the embers you find throughout the land, or you can kill a boss. These embers are limited, so be careful. These restore your maximum health, and also blend your world with the world of NPCs and other players. Lord of Cinder form allows you to recruit these NPCs as helpful allies to take down a boss. However, it also allows them to invade your world and challenge you.
So let's talk combat. For newcomers, it's important to note that this is not God of War. This is not a button-mashing combat system where you swing first and ask questions later. Far better to take a reactionary approach to combat. Watch your enemies, learn their attack patterns. There's a lot to know, but we're gonna start with what the buttons do. Think of the triggers as your hands. Whatever you've got in your right hand will be used by R1 and R2, and the same goes for the left. Mostly people have a weapon in their right hand. For this, R1 is attack, and R2 is strong attack. If you've got a shield in your left hand, L1 is to block, and L2 will parry, initiate a weapon art, or shield bash your opponent. It all depends on the size and type of shield. Now the face buttons. We'll talk about buttons for both PS4 and Xbox One controllers. If you want to carry a weapon in both hands, press triangle or Y. This does more damage and changes the moveset of the weapon. However, attacks will take more stamina and time. If you're two-handing with a weapon, L1 is to block, and L2 will perform that weapon's special skill. Some weapons come in pairs. You can't two-hand these, but the same button will dual-wield them. In this mode, L1 doesn't block, but attacks with both weapons. To dual-wield other weapons, hold triangle or Y. To interact with the world, for example, opening doors or resting at bonfires, press X or A. Using an item is square or X. These are things like using your Estus or applying weapon buffs. Down on the D-pad changes which item is selected. Right changes what's in your right hand. Left changes what's in your left hand. And up changes which magic spell you have selected. We've deliberately left one button for last, and that's your roll button, which is circle or B. You're gonna find it very important to roll in Dark Souls 3. There's a small window during your roll when you're invincible to most attacks, which means if you time it right, you can use it to evade almost anything. Holding down on the roll button will make you sprint, and while sprinting, you can jump by pressing down on the left thumbstick. It's the only jump button in the game, and you can use it to get to tough areas. If you press R1 while sprinting, you'll also do a sprint attack. There's also a unique attack for when you're coming out of a roll. Lastly, by pressing the roll button while standing, you'll perform a backwards hop, which might just barely put you out of range of an attack, and can be followed up with R1. Now here's something that you absolutely need to know. Pressing down on the right thumbstick locks onto an enemy and allows you to move relative to their position. You can strafe around them, it's easier to roll, and you can still run. While locked on, if you flick the thumbstick to either side, you can toggle between enemies. And if you find your way behind your target, R1 will initiate a backstab for critical damage. You also have a kick attack available to you, and this game actually has an item that improves your kick attack. It's great for those enemies that never lower their shield, and you can pull it off with a quick flick forward on the left stick and R1. If their guard is broken, you can even follow up with a critical attack by tapping R1 in front of them. Though I can think of a few enemies I'd rather kick off a cliff than fight outright.
Every part of combat revolves around the weapon you use, and weapons differ in more than just stats. Every weapon has its own distinct moveset, and different classes of weapons have different styles. The most effective builds are those built around the weapon you use. In Souls games, there is something called weapon scaling. For example, some weapons become much stronger the higher your dexterity is, and this degree of scaling is visible here. From best to worst, scaling is S, A, B, C, D, E. You should check this for every weapon you use, because some weapons may be more powerful with scaling. If you want to compare weapons, equip one and look at its alternatives in your inventory. Ones with higher damage output will have a blue value here, and weaker ones will show a different value in red. But remember, weapons are more than just the damage they do. It's about their range, their moveset, and their speed. In Dark Souls 3, weapon categories now have a unique skill move, which costs focus to perform. Let's go through the weapons. Swords are good all-rounders, with some thrusting and some slashing attacks. Using the weapon art of a standard sword will put you into a stance. From this stance, you can press R1 to do a guard break attack and R2 to do a charge dash attack. Axes and maces are more strength-based, and after successive attacks, are better at wearing down your opponent's guard. This triggers a state of weakness, which you can capitalize on by tapping R1 right in front of them. The axe's special skill is a war cry that will temporarily increase your damage, whereas the mace will temporarily increase your poise. Other weapons like bows or spears or halberds, they require a bit more finesse, and the damage they do will increase with your dexterity level. A short bow's weapon art, for example, will fire quick shots, whereas a longbow will fire one strong, shield-penetrating shot. A crossbow will shoulder charge an enemy to give you some space. The wide, horizontal sweeps of the great weapons are perfect for taking on multiple enemies at once. As you can probably tell, these weapons require a huge investment in strength to wield properly. The weapon art for the greatsword is tricky. It requires a double input of L2 followed by R2 for a different move. If there's something like a pillar or a shield in your way, then you can swing left to right instead of vice versa. Other heavy weapon arts might just be a massive smash. In the more claustrophobic altercations, you might be better off using a rapier or a spear. These weapons allow you to attack from behind a shield, and their weapon art charges you forward, penetrating an enemy's defense. It's important to note that shields are also unique. If you press L2, some shields will parry, whereas some will bash the enemy, depleting their stamina. Other shields will perform your weapon art if you press L2. If you're not sure what's going to happen, you can check the item description to see what kind of shield you're using.
You'll notice that all weapons use different amounts of stamina and have different animations with different speeds for attack and recovery. It's important to know these speeds because in the recovery period, you are extremely vulnerable. There's so much to tell you, but the most important thing we can really say is that you should be observant. Every enemy has their own moveset, their own style. If you're observant, then you'll notice attack patterns and you'll learn the best method for taking out enemies, even if it's through trial and error. For example, this enemy will always attack you after you hit him with his shield up. Get behind him and backstab him, or break him down with one of Dark Souls 3's new shield pierce attacks. Try learning how to bait enemies into attacking, so you can either block or avoid their attacks and then retaliate with your own. Watch the duration of their attacks and look for openings, and make sure you can recover in time to be able to block, roll, or evade again. Do you see what we mean? You should be keeping a little enemy journal in your head so you know how to deal with them in the future. But generally speaking, enemies are open to attack after they finish their own attacks. Many hollows are extremely vulnerable after they finish a flurry of attacks, so either dodge or block, and then follow up with an attack of your own.
Some weapons can also inflict unique status ailments, and the land of Lothric is full of enemies that will try and take you out using these more subtle means. If you see one of these bars building up, you should be on guard. For example, one new ailment that you haven't seen before is Frostbite. When your Frostbite meter reaches full, you become Frostbitten, and your stamina will barely regenerate at all until the meter drains again. Against most enemies, this spells instant death, so be very, very wary of the cold. Another ailment is poison, which can be inflicted in a variety of ways. If the poison bar reaches full, you'll slowly lose health over a period of time until the poison finishes or is cured. If you see toxic build up, this is really one to be afraid of. Toxic is just like poison, except it works a lot faster. One can also be cursed, and while it's rare, being cursed will result in instant death. Certain gear will help you avoid poisoning, curse, bleeding, and frostbite, and some items cure it, or you can just avoid these things entirely through sheer skill in combat. Dark Souls is harsh but fair. You start the game confused and weak, but by pushing through and overcoming adversity, you'll be able to master combat in Dark Souls 3.
You can't get through Lothric without at least mastering the basics of combat. But should you choose, your true weapons could be sorceries, miracles, and pyromancy. For magic users, spell castings are limited by your mana, which replenishes at the bonfire, as well as your Ashen Estus Flask. The Ashen Estus Flask is new to Dark Souls 3 and functions like an Estus Flask. Visiting Andre the Blacksmith will allow you to allocate your uses of Estus Flask between the normal health replenishment and focus point replenishment of the Ashen Flask. This may be more useful if you wish to use lots of magic, pyromancy, or sorcery, as well as the various weapon arts that use focus. But let's get into the difference between sorcerers and clerics. A sorcerer's power comes from intelligence and mainly deals with either magical energy, dark energy, or fire. You need a staff to cast these spells, though some weapons also do this, and these are held in your hand with R1 to cast. Your first sorcery teacher is Yol, found at the edge of the bridge at the start of the Undead Settlement.
Oh, then it's true. The Champion of Ash, as I live and breathe.
After talking to him at the bridge, he'll appear here in your shrine and offer to teach you a few basic spells.
I believe that I can help tease out your true strength.
However, your main sorcery teacher is found in the forest upon the Road of Sacrifices. He offers to teach you a wider variety of spells and will even teach you more powerful spells if you bring him the appropriate scrolls.
In exchange for my teaching, you will bring me knowledge in the form of scrolls detailing sorcery's secrets.
Moving on, pyromancers require a pyromancy hand to cast their fiery incantations. This weapon scales with both intelligence and faith. Your first pyromancy teacher is Cornix, found in a cage in the Undead Settlement.
Care to learn some pyromancies from this old man?
Clerics are the holier magic users, and their power comes from faith. Their miracles deal in holy energy and lightning, and are also associated with dark magic. Instead of staffs, miracles are cast with a blessed item, such as a chime. Your first miracle teacher is Elana, a would-be firekeeper kept prisoner by Aegon in the Undead Settlement. Elana will appear in your shrine here to teach you miracles and read the tomes you find in the world. You can increase your magic damage by upgrading your staff, talisman, or pyromancy hand, just like you would with a melee weapon. Sometimes you'll buy spells from merchants, sometimes you'll find them in the wide world of Lothric. But all magic users need to level the attunement stat, which governs how many spells you can equip when you rest at the bonfire.
Not all problems in Lothric can be solved with sword and board. Sometimes you need to rely on the various items you find in the world to cover your weaknesses. So let's start with the main one. Your Estus Flask is basically a health potion with limited charges. Your Ashen Estus Flask is the same thing, but for focus. As you find Estus shards throughout the world, you can take these to Andre, the blacksmith, to increase the number of swigs your flask can hold. Similarly, if you find an undead bone shard in the world, then you can burn it in your Firelink Shrine bonfire to increase the potency of your Estus Flask.
Without those flasks, you'd want for life or focus. And they'll always stay with you. Why not treat them well?
Thrown items can also be very handy to lure enemies, such as knives. And a lot of enemies are weak to fire, making firebombs a welcome part of your arsenal. Through constant use, your equipment will also degrade, and you can see the status of your equipment in its own little health bar right below it. This is replenished when you rest at a bonfire, but because some pieces of equipment are hardier than others, you might need to make use of repair powder sold by the Shrine Handmaiden in the Firelink Shrine.
A pleasure to make thine acquaintance, Ashen One.
By rubbing resins on your weapon, you can imbue it with additional power. Pine resin, for example, will add lightning damage. Similarly, you can increase your resistance to these elements with pellets. A red bug pellet, for example, will increase fire resistance. These are items you'll find either through exploration or after combat.
And of course, you won't want to neglect rings. Dark Souls 3 lets you wear any four rings at one time. Rings grant you various benefits, for example, increasing HP, increasing load, increasing physical or elemental defense, or even increasing resistance to poisons or curses. Rings are a great way to buff your character without having to level up. Their effects can be stacked with other rings or items to make you even stronger. The key here, again, is experimentation. As soon as you find a ring, try it on and see how it affects your play. There are dozens of rings in Dark Souls 3, and while there is only four ring slots, this means that you're going to have to choose what you wear and when you wear it to face the many challenges in the game.
From time to time, as you seek the Lords of Cinder, your world will blend with others. The timelines and spaces of Lothric are such that the journeys of others will bleed into yours, even if they're not of the same land or time. This can be both beneficial and dangerous. You'll come across soapstones in your travels, which allow you to write messages to others. These messages will permeate between worlds and can be used to help or hinder fellow adventurers. You'll also see illusions of other travelers from time to time. This will happen most often around bonfires, where weary travelers rest. If you come across one of their bloodstains, you can touch it to witness the last 10 seconds before they die. Bloodstains give an idea as to how someone died and what traps or enemies may be ahead. White sign soapstones forge an even stronger connection between worlds. By writing your sign, someone can summon you into their world to engage in jolly cooperation. You can do the same thing. If you're in human form, having used an ember and not died since doing so, you can summon white phantoms to assist you in boss battles. Some of these are human, and some of them are NPCs you need to have met during the game, who will often leave their summon signs close to the boss fog gate. There are also those who will invade your world without wanting to help you. You'll see these as red phantoms on screen, and that means it's time for player versus player combat. Defeating a player in this way will get you a reward in the form of souls and possibly embers. Defeating an NPC invader will reward you with their gear. When someone invades your game, you'll be warned with an on-screen message.
Lothric is an open world, and though you might find certain paths easier, you can explore it any way you like. Often in a Souls game, you'll find that the level loops back around on itself, and perhaps provides a shortcut to a bonfire you had already lit. These changes to the world are permanent, and they are the equivalent of reaching a small ledge you can rest on while you're climbing a mountain. If you're clever, sometimes you might even find shortcuts that drastically reduce the time it takes to get to a boss. These powerful, twisted souls are not like the bosses in most games. They each have something special about them, and sometimes killing them is much, much more than just hitting them over and over.
If you are going to beat those tougher enemies, you're going to need some advanced combat tactics, and one of the most useful is parrying. If you're holding a parry shield, you can attempt to parry an enemy right before their attack hits you. Some weapons, like some katanas, can also parry with their weapon arc. This will trigger a vulnerable state, in which you can press R1 to run them through for high damage. Parrying is high risk, but also high reward, and one of the favorite tools of experienced players. And it pays to focus on enemy animation cues. Usually there will be a kind of tell before an enemy attack, either a way they move or a sound that they make. Memorizing an enemy moveset is a sure way to increase your effectiveness in combat. Your weapons can be upgraded using various materials you find throughout your journey, increasing their damage and their scaling. If you like the feel of a particular weapon and you want to stick with it, start upgrading it. To do this, you'll need a blacksmith, and one can be found right at the start of your journey at the Firelink Shrine.
Reinforcement requires titanite, and infusion requires gems.
A shard of titanite will upgrade most basic equipment. After that, you'll need large titanite shards, then titanite chunks, and a titanite slab. Some special weapons even use twinkling titanite. Beyond this, there is even the option to infuse weapons with the powers of fire, magic, lightning, and darkness. For example, the heavy gem will make your weapon scale a lot better with strength.
Infusing weapons with gems requires a special kind of coal. My humble coals won't be any use infusing more unusual gems.
As you take out bosses and collect their souls, you can actually turn these into weapons and spells too. As soon as you acquire the transposing kiln, take it to Corland at the shrine and see what he has to say.
In transposing a twisted soul, its true power transferreth to thee.
Believe us when we say things will only get tougher. So make sure you're up to the task and don't neglect the crafting process.
Throughout your journey in Dark Souls 3, you might come across Covenant items, like the Warrior of Sunlight medal or the Way of Blue Parchment. These can be equipped in your Covenant slot in your inventory, which is right next to the armor slot. Covenants are factions or groups that you can align yourself with and carry with them unique effects.
If you fear trespassers, dark spirits drawn by the embers, then etch this upon your heart.
Some covenants have rules an NPC will explain to you when you join. Most covenants reward you for giving their leader certain items gained by performing tasks such as invading other players or helping them in co-op. Look around Lothric and the various areas to see what covenants you can find. Read their description and take part in their associated activities to see what rewards you can reap. We hope this video has given you what you need to get into Dark Souls 3.
But there's still plenty to discover on your own. The rest is up to you. May the flames guide your way. So we've covered the basics of combat in Dark Souls 3. Now let's cover some more advanced strategies. We recommend keeping a few tangible, consumable souls on you just for those situations when you need to buy something at the Firelink Shrine. If you've got zero souls but really want to upgrade something, that's when they'll come in handy. You can get some free levels after you befriend Yol the Sorcerer.
Let your true strength shine.
He won't do it all at once, but if you keep visiting him, he'll level you up 5 times for 0 soul cost. Hit every treasure chest exactly 1 time before opening it. Trust me. When they see you, the first action that some enemies will take will be to transform into something else. Memorize where these enemies are and kill them while they're still harmless. Certain enemies are weak to certain elements. Many are weak to fire, and in more extreme examples, this can be the difference between killing something in 10 hits or killing it in 1. Shielded enemies are easier than ever to take out using the new weapon arts. The pointiest of swords, like the Mailbreaker, can go right through them. Longbows also have a shield-penetrating shot. Daggers can get you around the back, and the sword's basic weapon art breaks their guard. After you get to know an enemy or boss very well, try evading their attacks without using stamina. Blocking is really hard on your stamina bar. See if you can strafe the odd attack, leaving enough stamina for maximum punish. Instead of soul vessels, there's a covenant now for reallocating your stats. All you need is 5 pale tongues. Find Rosaria at the top of the cathedral, but be warned. Pledging allegiance to her means others will see you as an enemy.
Gentle and kindle, if we meet again, it will be as adversaries.
Learn how many hits it takes to break someone's poise. It'll depend on the weapon. If it takes 5 hits to stagger someone, stop at 4 and regen your stamina. Then your next hit will stagger and you can get maximum punish. Right at the start of the game, there's a pretty good weapon available, but you'll have to defeat the Master to get it. He's a tough enemy, but there's a cliff right there. Dark Souls 3 is about to be released, and you might be wondering if the whole Dark Souls thing is for you. So we've put together some reasons why we love the game and why we think you will too. The core combat in the Dark Souls series is extremely well designed. The more critically you think about each encounter, the better you'll perform. All enemies have set attack animations and patterns that can be learned and countered. Attacks usually consist of a tell, where you start to see or hear the attack coming, and then the attack itself.
Much like a good teacher who designs a great course to educate his students, the mechanics and design of Dark Souls games push the beginner. When you become better, you'll wander back through the early parts of the game and wonder how you ever had a problem with these enemies. Dark Souls 3 is about perseverance, and the sense of accomplishment from defeating a boss is unrivaled in gaming.
The story of a Souls game is as deep or as shallow as you want it to be. For many players, Dark Souls 3 will be a game about killing demons and stealing their treasures. And this is fine. But for some, understanding the story is a core part of the experience. There is a rich tapestry of lore hidden in environmental details, item descriptions, and NPC dialogue.
A reenactment of the first blinking of the fire. So it is. I became a Lord of Cinder. I may be but small, but I will die a Colossus.
You only have to look a little closer, and you'll realize why the stories in these games make it a masterpiece.
Character design in Dark Souls is special. On the surface, many characters seem simple, but in most cases, their motivations and the secrets they hide make them fascinating. Take the Firekeeper, for example. She wants to help you and level you up, but there are hundreds more like her whose corpses are abandoned in a dark room behind Firelink's shrine. Ludlith of Corland tells you he was burned when he sacrificed himself to link the fire, but why does he hold a ring that supposedly belonged to a terrifying beast that had to be burned to end its rampage? This is good character design, and the same goes for the world. Tiny details are hidden in the environment, like undead being kept in cages because they are undying and can't be buried, or how you can see a giant firing an arrow early in the stage, which should make you wary when you come across a field of giant arrows in the ground later.
Expanding on the mechanics of the game, multiplayer in Dark Souls not only benefits from its excellent mechanics in making versus play incredibly fun and rewarding, but it also makes it an essential part for newcomers to get into the series. From the helpful or hindering messages around the game world, to the ability to summon people to help you complete sections of each level or boss fight, Dark Souls is known for its unique multiplayer. Each time players jump online, they'll come across a different configuration of weapons, armor, and playstyles that'll make them want to further explore the world and increase their own fighting repertoire.
Dark Souls 3 has a densely packed early game, full of weapons, miracles, spells, and teachers that help make your character feel distinct. Playstyle depth has also been improved, with the addition of the Focus Bar and Ashen Estus Flasks. The ability to refuel your focus allows you to become more liberal with your spells, and weapon arts grant your weapon more character.
With the wide variety of weapons, classes, and armor sets, Dark Souls 3 offers a massive amount of replayability for gamers. Each class calls for different approaches to combat and requires different strategies for tackling not only the AI enemies and bosses throughout the game, but also the opponents you find online. FromSoft continually patched the game to provide more balanced gameplay, and the DLC offers even more worlds to explore and item sets to add to your arsenal.
It's rare to find someone who's only ever completed Dark Souls once. The world is so deep, often you'll have to spend more time in it to unlock its full mysteries. And when the game finishes, you can play it again on New Game Plus, where everything is harder, and there may be more special things that were previously unavailable. Or maybe you just want to play a different way. Use sorcery instead of melee, or try a dexterity build with bows instead of that big two-hander.
Playing Dark Souls makes you a better gamer. It's as simple as that. We've talked before about how leveling up and improving your gear is important, but it's most important to level up yourself. Often you'll find yourself going through lower level areas and absolutely smashing it. But only a small part of that is your increased health bar. You're smashing it because you know the timings, you know the patterns. Just as if you were the actual character in the game, you defeat your enemies because of your expertise.